Let's prepare our heart and mind for the continuance of the service. Now, I just want to announce to everyone that please join us in our evening meetings. We started at 8. We are using the same number as we normally do. So please do so, so we can receive the same benefit as others. It's the same blessings. We have Wednesday, 8 o'clock, and Friday, 8 o'clock. So join us. Now, I would like to welcome each one of you, and of course, we have a digital day, and it's a family of Brother Edwin, and our speaker today. They come as family, and can I mention their names as I definitely collected? But it's been with us how many times? And of course, we have some new faces that comes today, but they are not new to you. So welcome everyone. Now, before I start, I just want to share with you the thoughts of the day that I had during the past few days. It is the experience of Paul and how he had dedicated himself to God. Now, the text that I want to share with you today is found in the book of 2 Timothy, chapter 4, verses 8, 7, 8. And it says like this: I have fought the good fight, I have finished the course, I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness is stored up to me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day. And not to me only, but also those who have love and his appearing. So all of us are prayed by Apostle Paul to be one who will come with in the coming of the Lord. Now there is a certain satisfaction in the checking of the list. So maybe some of you have a bucket list in life, but the Apostle Paul has the life list. And it goes like this. So these are things that I accomplished. The list replaced. You feel satisfied and you spend your time well. You have got goals and you met them. Now, Apostle Paul had a little list. In Paul's letter, near the end of his life, he reviewed his accomplishment and tried to notice that he doesn't please any number of churches he started, though he started many. He doesn't review the length of miles he spent to spread the gospel, but he traveled far. He doesn't even list the sacrifice of family, of time, of pleasure that he made, nor does he name the important people he worked alongside. Instead, he lists the accomplishment of his spirit. He preserved before authorities, in prison, on storm-stuck boats. He didn't lose faith. He kept believing. He kept trusting. That's it. That's his bucket list filled. Now, all the great accomplishment of Paul's life, God wrote out of his preserving spirit. Paul recognized that none of these things were really on his merit. Paul asked, God answered. Paul trusted, God came through. Paul was willing, God directed his way. God will do the same for us. If we ask him, why not ask God and embrace our faith and put the right goals of the Spirit in your likeness today? Our better text is found in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 to 8. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the course. I have kept the faith. From now on, the crown of righteousness is stored up to me, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but all to those all who have loved his appearing. Now may we prepare our heart and mind as we get ready to receive the blessing of God.
Thank you.
Okay, it's time to introduce our participant today. Now we'd like to thank all the participants and in the service we have Sister Menji in the keyboard, Sister Menji Bowe. And along with her is three young people, young musician. We have Brother Caleb Musser, our pianist, and Brother Seth Musser, our pianist, and we have Brother Hans Alonso, violinist as well. And this is what we call the Mendes Ensembles. Mendes Ensembles and the Oxfil Ensembles as well. And on our inspiration, we are led by Elder Don Galloway. And thank you for the service. And with me is we have Sister Dobie Hichinova, who will lead us in our scripture reading. And our serving deacons will be Elder Nari Rivera. And we have a Brother Alex Borby. And your servant in the Lord, Brother Jojo Avila. Now, after me, we have the Tyson opening video, and I will lead a prayer afterwards. After that, we'll have this scripture reading led by Sister Toby. And our special number for our speaker speak to us will be rendered to the Lord by the siblings Brianna and Bryce. And our speaker is not new to us, but he's the elder of the Willingboro Church. And his family, I would like to invite them to stand, please. The family of Elder Edwin Abacan. Did you stand up, please? So everyone will recognize your eyes and know your mask as well. Welcome to Oxford International Church. And our speaker is elder of the Willingboro Church, as I mentioned, and we are so grateful of having you every time you speak to us. It's like remembering the past days during the time in NPUC, now NUB. And this family is not a small clan, it's a big clan in the Batangas. So the program will go on as this week projected and as I announced. God bless us.
The Waldenses lost everything when they put God first. Even then, they didn't give up. What can we learn from the Waldenses today to help us put God first in our own lives? In the 12th century, the Roman Catholic Church had prohibited the Bible from being read and understood by regular people. Persecution was certain for anyone who challenged the authority of the Church, and especially the Pope. The papacy had become the apocalyptic beast described in the Bible. During this dark period of human history, Peter Waldo renounced his wealth and focused on helping those in need. A movement started in France as lay preachers voluntarily abandoned worldly prosperity and lived in strict devotion to the Bible. The Waldensians' main goal was to make the Word of God available in the common language. In 1179, Waldo and one of his friends had to explain their faith before the Pope and a panel of three clergymen. The results of the meeting were uncertain, but the Third Lateran Council in the same year condemned Waldo's ideas. Waldo and his followers created a system whereby they would go from town to town and meet secretly with small groups of Waldenessians. There, they would confess sins and hold worship services. A traveling Waldensian preacher was known as a barba. The group would shelter the barba and secretly help arrange the journey to the next town. The Waldenses lost their positions in society and eventually had to escape to the hills and caves. They continued to put God first by explaining scripture to anyone they could find. Their movement was a light in the darkness. They were precursors to the Protestant Reformation and represented a remnant of people who refused to put their comfort above the kingdom of God. We are called to be the remnant today, also sacrificing our comfort and all we have if necessary, while sharing with others God's truth and his plan of salvation. The Waldensians put God first, even when it cost them everything. Their courage inspires us today. Jesus gave up everything to redeem us, and his love compels us to put his kingdom first in our own lives. As we return our tithes and promise, we are challenged to put God first.
Good morning, church. For our scripture reading, it's from the book of Ephesians, chapter 3, verses 16 to 20. I'm going to read it in the New King James Version. It says, that he would grant you, according to the riches of his glory, to be strengthened with might through his spirit in the inner man, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you be rooted and grounded in love, may be able to comprehend with all the saints what is the width and length and depth and height, to know the love of Christ, which passes knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, things according to the power that works in us. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we kneel down? Let's pray.
Let me help the church.
Just have a...
Today we'll be saying, trust his heart.
for this amazing song. I have to be honest with you that when I brought this same sermon in the Philippines, wherein I have to wake up 3 o'clock in the morning and I have to translate most of this in Tagalog, it was the same song. And trust his heart. And if you hear the lyrics of that song, if you don't understand that things is not going our way, and we don't understand everything around us, we just have to trust God. And it's the same thing that I will be bringing into you today. Now, we are so delighted to be here, because this is the very first proper face-to-face church service that we've been into. And thank you to Joy, that she's been very resilient, patient, to bring me and my family here. Because, tell you honestly, we are still doing our Zoom service. Because there's a lot of, let's say, I have to make a lot of persuasion, but to make it sure. And in Wanigoro Church, we have about 60 or 70 members. And for some reason, at Zoom meeting, that's only the best attendance we could ever have. For maybe because they don't have to dress up, they don't have to travel, and they just have to Zoom in, click, and they are there. But yet, they don't even show their faces too. You can only see their names. But now in Oxford International, thank you for giving us the opportunity to see us face to face, same faces. But I know and I'm sure that these young people have grown up already. I can't believe that now you must have had, you must have the number more of teenagers now than you used to be. And it's going to be a wonderful opportunity for my children to meet you all. Hopefully, before the end of the day, you will manage to speak to them. It's always my prayer anywhere we go, in any churches. Okay, so how is Oxford International so far?
Very good.
Yeah, good. Well done. It's lovely to hear that. Because I believe in the last 18 months, we have been tried and tested. And that's what they say, COVID did not make us, but COVID actually exposed us. Now we knew where we are in terms of our spiritual lives, in terms of our financial lives, and even tested our family lives too. Because in the last 18 months, we only have each other, our families have each other. We can, for the last year, maybe 12 months, we never managed to get out there. So we have our own family in the same house, sitting at the same places, and that's it. So it tested us, it exposed us who we are as a family. And in this moment, I would like to bring you today a story that is very familiar to all of us. And I entitled this, Who is Laughing Now? And this can be found in Genesis chapter 21, verses 1 to 21. And we will go through these verses one by one. What is the story and what God tells us out of this story? To start with this, I overheard two girls talking, and they were walking as well. One girl said, you know what, I have 10 pence in my pocket. And the other girl looked at her hand and looked at her pocket, and she only saw 5 pence in her pocket. She said, you know, I only have 5 pence. And the first girl replied, you know, I may have 5 pence, you know, but when my daddy comes, he promised that he would give me another 5 pence, so basically, I am equal with you. Both of us will have 10 pence. So this little girl understood that her father's promise was as good as done, like a UPS parcel company objective that says considering dawn. So, brethren, Oxford International, I'm telling you that our Heavenly Father has a passion for you and for me to become like this little girl. He longs for us to take him at his word and trust that his promises are as good as done. Unfortunately, it is not always the case. We are always a bit cynical and we are always doubtful. We live in an era of unfulfilled promises. As you know, nations sign important treaties and then break them. We may have seen that in the last couple of weeks, we had G7 over in Cornwall. So these rich countries came together and they signed all these treaties and all these agreements all together. And now after a year or so, nobody just fulfilled those promises. So nations sign treaties and break them. Family lives are shattered because of little regards to wedding vows. And employers promise one thing and then they deliver another. No one seems to keep their words. That's why we have a sarcastic phrase that in our tired skepticism that we always have our eyes rolling, promises, promises, isn't it? But in Genesis chapter 21, verse 1 to 21, we will be challenged with a triple phrase. God always keeps what he promised. Therefore, we can trust him because he is faithful, he is powerful, he is sovereign, and definitely he is compassionate. So let us pray. Father God in heaven, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. O Lord, I pray. Amen. Right. So, here we are. We will open our Bibles in Genesis chapter 21, first in verse 1 to 7. And these verses can be seen in three different dimensions. 1 to 7, we will see it in three different dimensions. In verses 1 to 2, we will see the divine dimension in the birth of Isaac. And verses 3 to 5, it records the response of Abraham to the birth of his son. And in verses 6 to 7, we have the jubilance of Sarah over the arrival of the long-awaited child, the joy of her life. So, let's go verses 1 to 7. It says here, then the Lord visited Sarah as he said, and the Lord gave unto Sarah as he has promised. For Sarah conceived and bare Abraham a son in his old age, at the set time of which God had spoken to him. So, after 25 years, God fulfills his word to Abraham and Sarah. The miracle child is born. And Genesis declares, then the Lord visited Sarah. So this phrase focuses on God's supreme care and concern. And the other Bible translation says, he took note in a New American Version, or was gracious to her in the New International Version. So here we see God's grace and compassion is showcased. And when God says that, when the Bible says the Lord visited Sarah, you don't visit someone just for a visit, or you're just gate crushing. You made a special separate time. You allocated time, because that's what you call a visit, isn't it? So when the Bible says the Lord visited Sarah, it means that God, our God, the Lord, had allocated time to see Sarah, special to him. So notice the phrase, the Lord as well, is repeated twice in this verse. The point is that it is all God's work. It is Him. He made the visit. He made the promise. So in addition to God's grace, there are three important truths on how we will build our confidence in the Lord. First, we can trust God. We can trust God's word. So in this verse, in verses 21:1, three times in these two verses, in 1 and 2, it was referenced to God's word. As you can see, in 1 and 2, there is the phrase, as He said, and then He had promised, and in verse 2, which God had spoken. In this story, it may have taken 25 years for this promise to come to pass. But the Lord did what He had promised to Sarah. Brethren, the promise of a son was not fulfilled, not because Abraham was obedient, but because God was faithful to His word. Okay? So we can trust God's word. Second, we can trust God's power. The birth of Isaac was the accurate validation of God's power. God defied nature and biology just to make this happen. He intervened in the bodies of Abraham and Sarah and performed a miracle. You know, God still performs miracles in our lives today. And yet, many of us simply ignore it because we always wanted to be in control of the outcome of our situations. We don't thank God, we don't give God the credit in all of this because we thought of having control of our situations, we did everything on our own accord. Now, how many of you have seen a belt and suspender man? Have you seen anyone who is wearing a belt and then a suspender at the same time? Yes? It is actually some sort of fashionable back home then. I don't know about now. But I have seen quite a lot in here too. You know, a belt and suspender man is someone who wears a belt and a pair of suspenders to hold the trousers up. Yeah? That way, even if the belt breaks, he's still being covered and still suspended, of course, with a suspender. And then he likes, a man like this, he likes to have a clear strategy to deal with every possible problem before it occurs. While this may seem to make logical sense in the natural realm, God wants us to live in trust in His miraculous power instead of always trying to cover all our bases to take the credit. There is a saying that we cannot put your fingers in all the pies. Let God do what He does best. And God said it, therefore we must believe it. So, the second, we can trust God's power. Next, we can trust God's timing. Okay? Back to this story. I know some people who never come on time in my church. Maybe you know as well those people who never come on time to this church. And even in my workplace, I know exactly the same people who never come on time at work. Not so with God. He is never early, He is never late, He is always on time. And in the case of Abraham and Sarah, God did what He promised. Not a year early, not a year late, not a day early, or not a day late. God does not operate on our timetables. Our wristwatches or even our compasses doesn't rule Him. His timing may be personally inconvenient for you and me, but it may not make sense, but it will always at the appointed time. This means there's no way, or why should we fret? Why should we fuss about it? And why are we fuming when God does not operate according to our schedule? It is better to say, Lord, your will be done. And it is included even in his prayer. We have to remember that patience is one of the fruits of the Holy Spirit, right? But for patience to grow, it must be tested. And personally, I found that God repeatedly put me in these situations that require a great deal of patience. So why not join in how God works instead of making ourselves miserable? So these three truths demonstrate God always performs what he promised. Trust in his word, trust in his promise, and trust in his timing. So, now to our story in chapter 21, verse 3 and 5. Genesis picks up Abraham's response. And it says, Abraham called the name of his son who was born to him, whom Sarah bore to him, Isaac. Then Abraham circumcised his son Isaac when he was 8 days old, as God had commanded him. Now Abraham was 100 years old when his son Isaac was born to him. It could be in the New International Version now. So Abraham was 100 years old when Isaac was born to him. And in these verses 3 and 4 now emphasizes Abraham's obedience. The key phrase here is as God had commanded him. So upon the birth of Isaac, Abraham immediately called his boy Isaac. And Isaac means God smiled, or he loves, right? So the name Isaac was a standout in the pages of history as a constant reminder to the world that on one hand, God's promise is a loving mother, and in the other hand, God's promises is not a loving mother. Some people, it's a hilarious event because of its impossibility from a human's perspective. The moment we hear that Abraham is at the age of 100, and perhaps Sarah at the age of 90, they will have a child. Now at this present state, at our world now, it is an hilarious event. So, Abraham also obeyed God by circumcising him when he was 8 days old, and this was command, is part of the covenant, right? What we have studied in our lesson study in the last quarter. And now move on to verse 5. Verse 5 concludes by emphasizing Abraham's age. And actually in Hebrews 11:12 says that Abraham was as good as dead. And you may think you're old. I don't have to deny it now that Joy and I were in the same school, in Marina High School, and we're turning 50 this year.
Amen.
So, don't ever complain that we are old now. Because Abraham, at the age of 100, he's still capable of doing what he does best. Alright? So, at the age of 100, and you may think that Abraham could have been withdrawing pensions for 35 years, okay? Assuming that he could have a pension age of 65. He could have been withdrawing his pensions 35 years ago. And now he became a parent. Now at the age of 113, he would enter into the teenage years with his son. And at my current age, I complain I cannot keep up with my children already. So don't talk about challenging times. So in verses 6 and 7, the scene shifts to Sarah, who says, God has made laughter for me. Everyone who hears me love with me. And she said, who would have said to Abraham that Sarah would nurse children? Yet I have borne him a son in his old age. So I imagine that every time Abraham and Sarah called Isaac, they remembered how God had turned their laughter of disbelief to laughter of joy. Sarah became a mother at 90 years old, and Abraham becomes a father at 100. From God's perspective, it was a happy ending. So as often the case in life, there is after a mountaintop of experience, Sam usually descends into the valley. While we are on high, some people will be on the low. So this section of the second part of this story, there's another crisis in the story of Abraham. This is one of the strangest and the saddest portions of the Bible. So but in this section, we will learn that we can trust in God because He's a sovereign and compassionate God. So, forward to verses 8 and 9. Chapter 21. The child grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned, approximately 3 years after his birth. Now Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham. He's mocking. So 14 years earlier, say rewind, 14 years earlier, Hagar, the maid, had given birth to Ishmael, and for all these years, Abraham had treated Ishmael as the heir to his estate. He was the firstborn son. He was the center of attention there. By now, Ishmael was a teenager. He must be about 15 or 16 when Isaac was born. So, as a teenager, as a growing and alert teenager, there's no way missing the message that he was hearing. Since childhood, his parents had often told him that he was the promised seed. And now he gradually realized that his folks, that his parents were in error and they made a mistake. They had deceived him as well as themselves. So, as you can imagine, there was bitterness and there was anger that began to well up in Ishmael as the new boy Isaac, little by little, began to replace him. And no doubt, that great feast, that the great celebration, that the great glad speeches in Isaac's honor caused these feelings of bitterness to reflect themselves in ridicule and persecution. Ishmael, what he did, and how he did it, we can only guess. But one thing is sure, as the verse said in the Bible, Ishmael's jealousy had turned into a mockery. So I will ask you now, brethren, how would you feel when you are promised all the great things in the world, being loved and valued, has been the center of attention, and suddenly all these things was taken away from you? So, in verse 11, Sarah forcefully gave Abraham an ultimatum. Right. In verse 11 says, drive out this maid and her son, for the son of this maid shall not be an heir with my son Isaac. So, the mother distressed Abraham greatly because of his son. But God said to Abraham in verse 20, do not be distressed, because the lad and your maid, whatever Sarah tells you in verse 21, listen to her. For through Isaac your descendant shall be named, and of the son of the maid I will make a nation also, because descendant. So there were two promises here. Like all women, Sarah doesn't want to share her husband with her servant girl Hagar. But Sarah recognized that it is impossible for a man to enter into an intimate relationship with a woman and then simply walk away. The intimate relationship that Abraham had with Hagar was more than just physical. Abraham and Hagar became one. What they both have is more than a physical act. It is also a spiritual act that affects the mind, the emotions, and the soul. The evidence of this intimate relationship between Hagar and Abraham was Ishmael. And as we all know, Sarah consented for it. And they were all happy, united family then, and then were sharing the husband, and this time things have changed. She doesn't want to share her husband. She also does not want to share Isaac with Ishmael. And Sarah recognized that Isaac is the promised seed. So she doesn't want anything or anyone to adversely affect that. No. Of course, all this drama distressed Abraham. It is like a Korean drama, isn't it? Everything is there. Full of all the series of mishappen and all these events, uneventful. Yet, in verse 23, God reassured Abraham that he was divinely guiding Sarah's counsel. It says, husband, your wife is a God's gift to you. So she is to be treated as a treasure, like any valuable gift. Draw in her wisdom and unique perspective. Nurture and facilitate her. You and your family will be blessed as a result. And wife, it says in 1 Peter 3:4, and wife, when you speak to your husband, do so with self-control. Follow Peter's words and exude a gentle and quiet spirit. In this scenario with Sarah to Abraham, I think it's a bit messy. Abraham wants to follow the same mantra, of course, as most husbands are saying, happy wife, happy life, isn't it? So, move down to chapter 20, verse 14. It records these painful words. So Abraham rose early in the morning, and took bread and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar, putting them on her shoulder, and gave her the boy and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. This parting must have been the most excruciating. They were together as a family for at least 15 years, and everything has to end, just like this. I'm sure that Abraham never dreamt that sleeping with Hagar would lead to so much heartache and confusion. In fact, I am sure he tried to justify in his own mind the best way to make his wife happy and also to help keep God's promise. But it didn't work out that way. Sarah was wrong to suggest the idea, and Abraham was doubly wrong to act on it. And if Abraham had been the proper kind of spiritual leader, so much heartache would have been avoided. And brethren, in our Christian lives today, when we compromise our standards and lower our convictions, and when we try to take a moral or ethical shortcut, it never works out in the end. And sometimes for every choices we make, there are always consequences. And sometimes the consequences are painful. And this is exactly what's happening with Abraham at this time. And as believers, we need to learn this lesson very well. We also need to make sure that our children and our grandchildren will follow on these lessons in early life. Choices have consequences. When we sin and we confess that sin and we ask forgiveness for that sin, but we always have to remember the consequences of that mistake and error will always stay. And we have to remember as well that even the Bible has said, even to the third and fourth generation. And what happened to Abraham, to Isaac, and Ishmael is exactly what's happening in Palestine and Israel now. And even in the Arab world, and even in the Middle East. Because they are the fruits of Ishmael and Isaac at this present time. So the mistake that Abraham made is actually going through and still happening until this time. Anyway, now back to our story. In verses 15 to 16, we read, when the water in the skin was used up, she left the boy under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite to him, about a bow shot away, and she said, Do not let me see the boy die. And she sat opposite to him and lifted up her voice and wept. So I might have been reading now the New International Version. Now, here in this story, this is the very first record of a single mother in history. Like other single moms, she is without child support. In this particular situation, all that she had was given few gallons of water and a picnic lunch. And they were sent away. She is now at the end of her rope. So she lifts up her voice and she cries. And I am sure some of us can relate the very situation that Hagar was in this particular situation. In verses 17 to 19, we read the touching words, God heard the lad crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, what is the matter with you, Hagar? Do not fear, for God has heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad, and hold him by the hand, for I will make a great nation of him. Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water, and she went and filled the skin with water and gave the lad a drink. So notice here, it was not Hagar's cry that captured God's attention, but the boy's cry. It is no coincidence that the name Ishmael means God hears. As a descendant of Abraham, Ishmael was the subject of God's special care. His cries brought divine intervention. We all know that God loves children and he also desires to be the God of the outcast, to be the God of the rejected, and the God of the abused, and God of the dying. He is always the same God for everyone. When we have come to the end of our resources and we sit down to solve, remember, God has a lot of options left. He hears, he calls, and he opens, like what Jesus said in our scripture reading. And I love the fact that Hagar saw the well that had been there all along. Only her tears and her fears kept her from seeing it. And brethren, God always provides, but often we don't see it. Most times we're too busy crying, we're too busy complaining. We're not looking with any hope or faith that God provides. When I was growing up, and even until today, if I cannot find things I am looking for, my mother then And this is exactly what happened to Hagar. That well, that is their lifeline, has been there all along. But because he was crying, he cannot see it. And that is the same thing for us. And I am aware that there are people who are being emotionally or physically abused and has to continue in a relationship because they are afraid of the financial, the emotional, and the physical wilderness. Then pay attention to Hagar's situation. Even though she suffered greatly, her need for support was supplied. And God did not forget Hagar. He did not even forget his promise to greatly multiply her descendants. And God had compassion on Hagar's plight. And God became like a father to Ishmael. Now I bring it to you this question. Do you believe God provides? Single mothers, can God meet your needs? Wives who are married to an unbeliever, can God be your husband? Can he provide for you? Our children, our teenagers, who has been victimized by parent separation, can God provide? Yes, 1,000 times yes. And the story closes in verse 20 and 21 with these encouraging words. The story closes like this. God was with the lad, and he grew, and he lived in the wilderness and became an archer. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother took him a wife from the land of Egypt. Now, brethren, again, God demonstrated his sovereignty and his compassion. And Moses in the book of Genesis says that God was with the lad. Some of us have watched our sons and daughters make wrong decisions and choices. Those children move in destructive wrong and destructive directions. They walk away from God. We watch our children go into the desert, and we desperately wanted to stop them. Now we knew there was nothing we can do. Our heart was broken, like the heart of Abraham. But I may remind us all, today, God hears our cry. He can open a way in the life of our wayward children, and He is always with our child. We can trust God because He is a sovereign and compassionate God. So, in closing, how many of you know the story or even the movie The Chronicles of Narnia? Have you watched it? And apparently it was a book before by a famous philosopher named C.J. Lewis, who happens to be a fantastic student here at Oxford University. Right, and I watched this with my children, and this wonderful children's story is about the magical land of Narnia. But in the second book, it is entitled Prince Caspian. In that story, I don't know if you have a DVD in your home or even a book in your home, you can read through this about this particular story, or in this particular side of the story. In this story, Lucy, one of the main characters, enters Narnia again and sees Aslan. Aslan is the big lion who can talk, and because C.J. Lewis is a theologian and a philosopher, he is considering Aslan as God. So, the great lion. She has not seen him a long, long time ago. So, because from the first book, now in their second book, they haven't seen each other. And so they have a wonderful reunion in this story. Lucy says to Aslan, "Aslan, you're bigger now." And Aslan says, "Lucy, that's because you are older. You see, Lucy, every year that you grow, you will find me bigger." Brethren, hasn't that been the case for many of us? For many of us, every year we grow spiritually, we find the Lord bigger in His faithfulness, His power, His sovereignty, and His compassion. Why? Because in our text that our sister have read, God is always bigger than you and I could ever ask or imagine. So, as we conclude this sermon, do not forget these words. God always performs what He promised. We can trust Him today, and the promise that He has given us, we can depend on all through all the days of our lives. Because if He said it, we must believe it. And brethren, that is my God, and I pray that you will find Him the same. Amen.
Amen.
Our faith and our Christian lives too. And the story of Abraham, of Hagar, of Sarah, of Isaac, and Ishmael did look. It's a wonderful story about to remind us that your promises are true and you always provide. I'm praying, dear Lord, for all the blessings that you will give to each and every member of Oxford International Church, now and forevermore. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.